Hi, thanks for choosing to play this video. What I'm trying to do here is explain what this new product that I'm designing, the digital MPPT thermal controller, what it's all about and what is it good for. And I'll try to keep the explanation as simple as possible. And I will use the presentation I made, the PDF presentation I made. That you can find the link to it in the description. I will use this to keep me on track, and I hope I will not go too much out of the discussion and try to keep this video as short as possible. I'm sure it will be a long video, no matter what I do, but I will do my best to keep it short. So let me start. On this first page, you can see a photo of the first beta sample of the digital MPPT, and it's almost at the right scale compared to the SBMS 100 that some of you already have. And so you if you have the SBMS 100, you can get an idea of how large this this other device will be. And yeah, the new Solar BMS versions will be a bit different, but have a similar look to the old one, to the SBMS 100. And yeah, there will be two models, the SBMS 120, which will be a slightly higher version of this one, and an SBMS 40 that will be like a cost optimized version of this. And like the SBMS 120 will use the same connectors that you see here on the digital MPPT, so it will also be larger than SBMS 100 because of these connectors. And I will also use a larger LCD than you see on the SBMS 100. But the SBMS 40, that it's the cost optimized version, it will use the same LCD size, and it will use even like smaller connectors than these ones on the SBMS 100 and SBMS 60. But yeah, I will not talk any more about the SBMS in this presentation. I will try to explain mostly what this new digital MPPT thermal controller is all about. As many of you know, I live off-grid in a house that I designed and built. And I was trying to find a solution to heat my house in the most economical way possible. And after investigating many options for heating, I decided, I mean, not decided, but after making the calculation, I realized that direct solar PV heating will be the most cost-effective option. So, that's why I decided to design this digital MPPT, because you can of course just connect a resistive heating wire to a PV panel and you already have a heater. But the thing is that it will not be efficient, because the amount of solar energy hitting the panel, it's variable during the day, and it will also be variable for each day. If it's like cloudy, you get a much less and a much less current from the panels, because panels are just constant current power supplies. And so that's why I came up with this idea, which is not actually a very complicated idea, as you will see later in my presentation. I came up with this to increase the efficiency from around maybe 50, just 50 to 60% if you just connect a simple wire and to the panels and try to heat something, water or whatever, compared to the digital MPPT thermal controller that will actually try to maximize and use all the available energy from the PV panels depending on the amount of sun. So and it will do that by you'll see later, by switching a different value resistive elements in order to get a sort of variable resistance or a variable load. But a variable load, it's not a linearly variable like you'll have with a DC-DC converter. It's in steps. So you have, if you want to use the entire digital MPPT, you'll have something like 31 steps. But those are sufficient to get well above 95-98% efficiency, which is actually better than using a digital than using a DC-DC converter or switch mode power supply. Using that, you'll get probably lower efficiency than using the digital MPPT thermal controller. Plus, that one will be way more heavy than the digital MPPT controller, much larger and way less reliable, because it will need to use probably electrolytic capacitors, and those have a limited life. And then it will also be much more expensive to use a DC-DC converter. You need to know that this digital MPPT is able to use the energy from a 14 kilowatt PV array. So it's a huge amount of PV panels that it's able to maximize to use all the power from that huge PV array. And then having a DC-DC converter able to maximize the power from a 14 kilowatt PV array, it's not impossible, but I never seen any DC-DC converter of this size. I'm sure there are, but I never seen one used in solar, at least on small scales. I don't know what they use like industrially, but the point is that it's much larger, much more expensive, and much more complex and less reliable. So there's no point in making a comparison. Okay, so here you can see like a very simplified circuit diagram and how everything will be interconnected. I'm assuming here that you will use both digital MPPT thermal controller for heating and the solar BMS for the electricity. But the digital MPPT thermal controller can be used independently just for heating. So there is no need to have a lithium battery and a SBMS. That's just only if you want to have like a complete solution, like I will have for my house. I want also heating and electricity at the same time. So I will have a so-called net zero energy house, meaning that all the energy used in the house will be provided by solar, which is a renewable source of energy. So there will be no other type of energy, no natural gas or oil or anything like that. So everything will be provided by solar. And and I didn't choose solar because it's green, or that's just a bonus. I choose this because it's the least expensive option possible, as you will see a bit later. But okay, so as you can see, this the PV array will need to be at least 2 kilowatt in order to make sense to use the digital MPPT 450. I mean, this one is designed to be able to support at most a 14 kilowatt PV array, so it will not be really cost effective if you just want to use something smaller than 2 kilowatt, and you will also probably not be able to heat almost anything with less than 2 kilowatt. If you just maybe want to heat water or something, then yeah, that's fine. Maybe with a 2 kilowatt PV array, maybe even with a 1.5 or something. But yeah, it's the digital MPPT is designed for like larger heating applications. And with this, you will need, if you use the complete system, you will need a thermal storage, which is I will explain later what exactly the thermal storage is and everything, but a thermal storage will have a very large capacity, like at least 30 kilowatt hour up to 250 kilowatt hour. And this means that, and the reason for that is that thermal storage is extremely inexpensive. So that way, having a very large storage capacity, you can store all this energy from the large PV array and almost use it all during the winter. So this will help average the energy available, because you don't have energy during the night, just during the day with solar. So this will keep your house warm during the night, the thermal storage. And also it will be able to help keep your house warm for extended periods of time, maybe 3-4 days with very little sun, because it's maybe cloudy, overcast. And so this is the role of the thermal storage. And since it's it's almost 50 times less expensive in terms of cost amortization than lithium batteries, then it makes sense to have this as large as possible or as needed in order to take full advantage of the low cost of this complete system. And then the lithium battery can be when used in a combination with heating and thermal storage, the lithium battery can be actually only half of the capacity needed if you just use the SBMS and solar a fixed solar PV panel. You will see later this. But yeah, and what else? Digital MPPT will have 6 inputs, so the PV array will be split in 6 different sizes sub-arrays. So you'll have different smaller arrays that will all be connected to digital MPPT 450, and you also have 6 outputs. It's just a coincidence that you have the same number of outputs as inputs. That's not necessary. That's just a coincidence. You don't have each input connected to an output or something. All inputs will be connected together, and then all that will be sent to these 6 outputs. But I just want to make this clear, that the fact that I have 6 inputs and 6 outputs have nothing to do with each other. So I could have just 4 outputs and 6 inputs or something. It doesn't matter. I will explain later why I need multiple inputs and outputs, but the fact that there are 6 is just a coincidence. Okay, and now in order to understand why heating is such an important part of a house that you want to make a net energy zero, you need to see these charts and to understand, because space heating and water heating, it's a huge part of the energy used in a home. And maybe you will not realize this, because maybe you don't use electricity to heat your home. You maybe use natural gas, and that one, it's it's charged differently. You pay maybe by cubic meter or something, and you don't realize how much. And also, the natural gas is cheaper than electricity in almost any country I know. So you don't really see the fact that heating is such a big part of the house energy needs. And so I selected a few countries, each fairly different. And you can see even in Australia, which is a fairly warm place to live, much more than half of the energy needed to run the house, it's used for space heating and water heating. It's 35 with 23, it's 58% of the energy is needed to just for heating water and heating the space. And 5% of the energy it's used for cooling. And this seems hard to believe when you live in Australia. I don't live in Australia, but I had a lot of discussion with people that live in Australia, which got my solar BMS and are maybe interested in digital MPPT. They don't understand that steel heating is much, much larger part of the house energy needs than cooling, even if it doesn't look so. Because think about like this, the hottest day in summer, it's not the hottest day, but say average temperature in the hottest summer month, it's maybe, I don't know, say 30 degrees Celsius, which is just maybe 5 degrees above what will be comfortable for someone to live in. Like 25 degrees Celsius in summers, if you have 25 degrees inside the home, you'll feel like that's a comfortable temperature. And the average outside temperature for that month, it's maybe 30 in a fairly warm place in summer. And then that's just 5 degrees delta between the average outside temperature and what you want inside. And in the winter, the same, like in Australia, maybe you have, I don't know, the coldest winter month, maybe it's around plus 5 degrees Celsius as average. Of course, you have probably below freezing and a little bit above freezing, but average, maybe it's plus 5, let's say. I don't know exactly, I just use, but this plus 5 degrees Celsius compared to, say, a 20 degrees Celsius like comfortable temperature in winter inside the home, it's already 15 degrees Celsius delta. And so in that cold month of winter, you will use, you'll need to use 3 times more energy in order to maintain the house at a comfortable temperature compared to summer and cooling. And on top of that, the way you do cooling usually it's, it involves using a heat pump. So, and usually heat pumps have a so-called coefficient of performance that is above one, meaning that maybe if, say, the heat pump that you use, the air conditioning that you use, it's has a coefficient of performance of 3, which is not unusual. And then if that's the case, then what you do, you put in 1 unit of energy and you get you move out 3 units of heat. So adding that to the fact that you already have 3 times less energy needed to cool the room, the house at an average of 30 degrees in the respective month outside, then and coupled with a heat pump, it means that you need like 6 times less energy in order to cool the house in the hottest summer month than you need to heat the house in even in Australia, where it's not that cold in the winter. So, but then when you get to like colder countries, like maybe like Canada or Germany, then you see what huge amount of energy is used for heating, space heating and water heating. And not only that, this pie chart is the average for a year. You usually maybe have like 3 to 5 months of heating season. But when you are in that heating season, like it's maybe you need 10, even 15 times more energy for heating than you need for all other electrical appliances, for lighting and everything else. And yeah, that's what I wanted to, why I wanted to show this graph, so you understand this. And for more details and to see more countries, you can go and check this publication from International Energy Agency that has like a lot more data that I put in here. I wanted to keep it simple. And then this is the space heating and water heating is what the digital MPPT 450 will take care of, and all the rest of the stuff will be taken care by the solar BMS and lithium battery. So if you have these two system, they will be able to provide all the energy for a house. Okay, and here is just a graph with from the same paper that I mentioned before, and you can download it here. You have how much energy is used for a house by per unit of area per square meter in different countries. So of course, even if the houses are thermally insulated the same, if you have one that it's in Australia and one that it's in Canada, of course the one in Canada will need much more energy for heating in the winter. So of course it will require more energy per square meter or per surface area for the same livable surface area. But this is again is an average for all types of houses and apartments and everything. It's an average, and an apartment will use much less energy than a standalone house, because it has much less surface area to outsides. It maybe has only an apartment maybe has only one or two external walls, and then that's like the amount of heat loss. It's much lower for an apartment than a house, which has everything exposed to outside, the roof, the all four walls, and the even the if it has a basement or something, that will also lose some heat. And also I included my house, which is I did that because to show that in fact my house, it's not an average or typical house. It's way better insulated thermally, because this is the average in Canada that, like I said, includes apartments and everything. And also most people in Canada live in a warmer area than I live here in Canada. And it's the house, it's way better insulated, at least 3-4 times better than any standard new house built in Canada now. So you need to take this in consideration when you see this example in this paper, the example for heating. So now this is where I compare three different heating options for my house. So this is an example for my house in terms of cost and everything. And I choose to use to compare the PV heating with thermal solar and natural gas, because like many people ask, why use electricity to heat your home when you can use much more efficient thermal solar panels? But thing is, they are more efficient, and they will take a less space. I mean, the collectors, the panels, like two times less area will be needed for a thermal panel than for a PV panel, but with the same output power. But the thing is that it will be more expensive, as you can see here, the total. And I also compare it with natural gas, because I think at least 50% of all houses in the world are heated with natural gas, because natural gas is the cheapest form of fossil fuel energy that you can use. And of course, because it was the cheapest in the past, most people already have a connection to natural gas and they use that. But if you need to build a new house, then the connection alone to natural gas will be more expensive than buying solar. But there are many things that you need to consider. So yeah, you can read everything in here in more detail, and the advantages and disadvantages of each of these options. And what I want to highlight is that the cost of natural gas here in because I use the cost of natural gas in this province in Canada, it's actually I'm pretty sure it's the cheapest one in the world. So you need to check your the cost of natural gas in your area and then try to make a similar calculation in order to compare things, because here it's just insanely cheap at the moment, and I use the price that I found now this month when I did this this comparison. But like just a year or two ago, it was like three times more. So it fluctuates a lot. So if you use that 2-3 times higher price per unit of energy, then you will get a way different result here. But even with this low price, which I don't think can be beat anywhere in the world, even in that case, natural gas, it's just no match for PV solar heating. And like I said, I didn't even include the connection fee. If it's a new house, then it's just, I would say it's out of question. There is no way you can get cheaper with natural gas than with solar PV heating. And but I added links to all this stuff, so you can check in detail all my calculation and everything. I'm pretty sure I didn't make any mistakes, but you can see the links to prices and everything that I used in here, and compare it by yourself, because it, like, the prices for maybe even solar panels and thermal panels and natural gas, they will can be widely different all over the world. So you need to check for your area, and also you need to check how much solar energy you have available and things like that. Like in the most northern European countries, there is not that much solar in winter time, so it's you really need to make the calculation for that. But just don't look just at the numbers and say, yeah, but it's not big difference between natural gas and like PV, because like I mentioned, your price for natural gas can be much higher, can be 5 times higher than mine. So you need to check this, and then you need to check solar. Maybe you can get solar panel even at a better price than I can here. And even if you have much less solar than I have here, because here it's a fairly sunny place, even if it's extremely cold, it's sunny. So and I know that in like most of those northern European countries, there is not that much sun, but even so, it's still possible that even with that low amount of sun, solar PV heating, it still can be a better option than natural gas. So you need to look into these numbers. It's just not, you cannot do like a comparison and be valid everywhere in all conditions and everything. But that's it. Like, this is my case. It's an example for my house, and you will need to look into this. But I'm pretty sure in almost all places, PV solar heating will be cheaper than anything else that you can think of. And I know many people mention like wood and maybe pellets or something like that, but those will be way more expensive than natural gas. You think, maybe even if you think that you can get the wood or the lumber for free to burn it, the stove, it's expensive. It needs to be to have a certain level of in some places you are not even allowed to burn wood, but where you are allowed to burn wood, you'll need to have a special stove, where you cannot burn wood just like that. And the efficiency of the burning stove is not that great, even the very good ones. And on top of that, that stove costs money, and it will not last that long. It will need a few replacements in 30 years time. And adding all those costs plus all the work that you need to do to get the wood, even if it's free from your own forest or whatever, and burn it, and all that work, it's it will make the heating more expensive even in that case. But if you buy the wood, then it's, yeah, it's no comparison with natural gas. Natural gas, it's clearly, it was the cheapest source of energy up to now. That's why it's so widely used in home heating. Okay, so let me go further. Now, this is the amount of solar that I receive at my location in with in this example I used the 10 kilowatt PV array because it's the amount of PV solar that I will need to install to fully heat my house in winter, and like it's a bit larger than I really need most of the time, but it's designed so that it can cover in worst case the heating for the house, because having two separate system, having a backup system, is just not a good solution. It will be more expensive no matter what. So if you just replace like 10% with another source of heating, having that separate source with separate heater and everything, it will get things much more expensive than just increasing the PV array size to be sure that it can cover in all conditions. So of course I will have a lot of like unused energy from the sun, especially in the summer when I don't do heating and I don't need any cooling in here, and then I will have huge amounts of excess energy. But it doesn't matter, that's not important, because what's important is the fact that I pay this amount, I buy all the panels, and then I don't care about heating in the next 30 years or more. So, I mean, the calculation is done here for 25 years amortization, but the panels will last more than 25 years. So, and there is nothing else to break. It's just heating cables, and there's no moving parts. No, at least in my system, I will have no water pumps or anything like that. So it's nothing to break on the heating system. Okay, so with 10 kilowatt of PV panels, I produce like 14.7 megawatt hour per year, or like 14,747 kilowatt hour per year. And as you can see here, it's uniform enough. I mean, even in winter time, like January, it's the most important for me because that's the coldest month here. I still have above 1,000 kilowatt hour, and from both calculations and measurements, because I lived here already, this is the fourth winter that I will spend here, I already know exactly how much energy this house needs to be kept at a decent temperature. And then because I use propane now, I use one of those like barbecue style propane tanks that has 8 kilograms of propane inside, and that actually contains about 100 kilowatt hour of energy. And all that I need about like 10-11 of those in January. Usually it depends on winter, some winters are warmer, some winters are colder, but around 10-11 of those propane tanks is what I use in January. And it means that I need about 1,000 kilowatt hour if it's 10 of those. But it's like the burner, the propane burner is just 80% efficient, so it's less than that. It's maybe 800-900 kilowatt hour per month, yeah, in January when it's the coldest. So yeah, I will have no problem providing that with this 10 kilowatt PV array. And also it will be like future proof, because you know PV panels will degrade over time. It's not much, it's like maybe 0.5% per year or less than that. So like in 20 years, 25 years, you maybe have only 80 or 85% of the initial power output. But because I have some extra, it will be no problem in 15, 20 years. And even if, say, in 25 years, I go down to 80 or 85% of the initial power output from the solar panel, I just buy like a couple of more panels, add to this PV array, and I'm, yeah, like good for another 25 years. But yeah, that's the calculation was done only for 25 years amortization. So everything what's above 25 years is just like a bonus. It's extra. It doesn't matter. Okay, and then here, this graph is from the same, like this is from PVVAT. It's an online calculator. You can link click on here and in the document and go to this website and check the amount of solar that you receive for your location. One thing you need to notice that the only thing that I changed here, except for the fact that I use 10 kilowatt hour of PV panel, is that I used a steep angle of 60 degrees, so I get the most out of my PV panels in winters when I need the most energy. So that's the only thing that is non-standard in here. I didn't modify any of the other parameters in here, so you can directly compare with my location. You just need to introduce your angle and system size. Okay, and then this is from the same website. You can download daily data, actually. I think it's hourly data, and then you can calculate how much energy you produce this is an average year. They measure the intensity of the sun and how much they can generate from PV panels in many places around the globe, and they did that for many years, and they made a sort of an average year, how an average year will look for solar. And this is really cool because you can see for each day how much energy you can produce. And what you can see here with a green dotted line, this is the average for a year. So how much was the daily average energy that you produced with this PV array. And it's a 10 kilowatt PV array, as I mentioned before. So a daily average of around 42 kilowatt hour per day is produced by this PV array. So, but what you can see is that even in, like, this is January here, because this is the beginning of the year, so day zero of the year, this January up to around here, so this part is January, what you can see is how bad is a overcast or cloudy day in here, like this one here. It's like, what's this, maybe 14 kilowatt hour of energy. So even when it's cloudy, you still produce quite significant amount of energy compared to an average day. Not compared with a sunny day, but with an average day, it's quite a significant amount of energy that you produce even in those days. And then you have here this is one of the worst in January one day. And you have something like maybe, say, 7 or 8 kilowatt hour. That's still a fair amount of energy that you can use to, like in my case, to power all my devices, to cook food and everything electrically. And because all that energy used inside the house will still end up as heat, will still heat up the house. So it doesn't matter where it is used, if it's stored in thermal mass or it is used for devices, it will still be end up as heat. And yeah, that's great, because I can use as much energy as I want for my appliances or devices. I don't have any limitation. And the battery, the lithium battery, only needs to provide energy for overnight. That's it. So I need a very small lithium battery. That means that cost amortization of the battery will be quite a bit lower than having a system that doesn't have the heating and the large PV array. So that's an important factor. So yeah, and also what you can see is how many bad days you can have. It's like maybe 2 or 3, but it's not that bad. It's like they are maybe even half of an average day. You still produce something. This is, of course, this is for my location. You will need to look for your location. Climate and amount of sun, it's different. So I have good sun resources. It's not the best, but fairly good. And even though it's extremely cold here, so I need a lot of energy to heat my house and keep my house warm. But It's fairly good. Like the worst part, it's here somewhere in November, but and November is not that cold, so I don't need that much energy. So having the same amount of thermal storage means that I can live with maybe even 5, 6, 7 days without heat, because there is not that cold in that period of time, and I already have the thermal storage full, so that will be able to maintain the house warm for many days in that climate. Even in January, I can maintain the house at a comfortable temperature for many days, 3 to 4 days, no problem. I do the same now. I mean, I cannot always heat with propane, even if I have propane, because when it's extremely windy, it will just my propane heater, my cheap propane heater, will not work. So it doesn't matter. It will still be comfortable inside because of the thermal storage. And here is where I explain the difference between having the PV array connected to like a fixed resistive heat element, and here is where introducing the digital MPPT helps a lot. Like you see here, it's when you have like half the amount of solar energy hitting your panels, because maybe sun is at an angle or because it's cloudy or whatever, then like the efficiency of a fixed resistor heat element that it's specifically calculated for this PV array size will be just 50%, where using the digital MPPT this will increase to 93%, and this is just it's a huge difference. Like the digital MPPT, it's extremely inexpensive, so it makes absolute sense to use something like that in order to increase by that much the efficiency. I have here a graph that shows a comparison between a fixed resistor and a digital MPPT. So fixed resistance means, like I mentioned before, using just PV panels and connecting a resistive heat element to that PV array directly. You just need to calculate, of course, the resistance to be at the maximum power point when you have the maximum amount of sun, so you get the most out of it. But if you do that, then what you get with a fixed resistor in a sunny day, it's this in blue, this area in blue. So the amount of energy is basically the area covered by this blue a blue graph, and it's impressively high. I mean, it's like 80%. So if it's sunny and you have like this fixed resistor connected to PV array, you can get 80% of the energy into that resistor and heat whatever water or space or whatever you want to do. And so that's fairly decent. But the thing is that like not all days are sunny and with full sun, like you've seen in the graph above. And even in this case, like with the orange is the total energy from the PV array that you can theoretically use, and with the green it's what the digital MPPT will be able to do. As you see in this case, it's 97.8%, so still there is a fair amount of additional benefit by using the digital MPPT even in a sunny day. And what you see here, like depending on what resolution you watch this video, but you can check the document, there are I don't know, like a sawtooth type waveform on this green graph, and that's where a different resistors are switched, because you have like six separate outputs, and you can select which one to use and any combination of them. And if you make combination of on and off on those six outputs, you can get like up to 64 63, let's say, combination. If you are a software guy or something, you know what I mean by to the power of six, the number of combination with six outputs. So that's what the digital MPPT will do automatically. It will switch to different loads, different heat resistive values, in order to maximize the efficiency. And in this other half of the graph, this is a cloudy day, a typical cloudy day. This data is real data. In both cases, this and this are real data logged by my SBMS 4080, the old SBMS 4080. And so this is a typical cloudy day with like you have a bit of cloud breaks and so on. And so it's not the worst cloudy day, but it's a cloudy day, and you can still see that, you see that with a fixed resistor, the efficiency in this case will only be 31.8%, which is, yeah, extremely low compared with a digital MPPT, which can, in this same condition, can get 93.5% efficiency for heating. And if you take like an average of all days in a year with sunny and cloudy and overcast and everything, you get something like with a fixed resistor, maybe an average of 55-60% efficiency, because you have a good solar day with maybe 80% efficiency, and then you have those bad days with maybe as low as 20% efficient in total overcast day. And then you have the digital MPPT, which has an average of maybe 96% efficiency in this case, average for the entire year or for the winter heating season or whatever. So it's a huge benefit to have a maximum power point, a digital one, like in this case. Okay, so here is like, this is the comparison that I was talking before. That so if you have a complete system, this is what my system will look like. It will have 39 panels, and you see it's FA1 panel, 2 panel, 4 panel, 8 panels, then 12 panels, because 12 is maximum for each input, so I cannot add more than 12. But since I have here 39 panels, and they are organized this way by switching on and off and making all sorts of combination, all possible combination of these six inputs, I can actually vary the input. It's not the input. What I can do, I mean, all these panels are connected all the time to the heating part, to the thermal storage. So that's always connected. I don't disconnect these inputs. They are always connected and used to store energy in the thermal storage. But what I can do, I can disconnect one of or more of these PV arrays, one of these six, disconnected from thermal storage and redirected to a battery storage, and so as needed. So if it's sunny, let's say, and like I have a 200 amp hour 24 volt battery, and I want to keep the charging at 50 to 60 amps, because that's the best for the battery for a long life. If you try to charge it faster, it will heat up and it will get damaged very fast. So it's not a good idea. You need to charge at about 0.2 to 0.3 charge rate, 0.2C. This means like 50 to 60 amps for a 200 amp hour lithium iron phosphate battery. That's optimum. So let's say it's sunny and it's in the middle of the day, and at the afternoon, I can connect these two panels and these four panels. I can redirect them to battery charging, and then the battery will charge at 50-55 amps, so just ideal. And all the rest of the other panels will push energy in the thermal storage. But then, say later on, when it's maybe later in the day, when the sun is at an angle to the panel or it's cloudier, then I can connect more. I can connect maybe these two PV arrays, or these three, or even all, if it's really overcast, and there is a very small amount of light, I can redirect all these 39 PV panels to battery charging, if of course the current doesn't exceed the limit, the 50 amp limit. But when you only use the SBMS, then you are limited to the amount of PV panels that you can install, so that the battery is not charged very fast. And so in the case of a 200 amp battery, you cannot actually use more than six of these large 260 watt panels, because otherwise you will charge your battery too fast and it will get damaged. But yeah, this is the graph here that shows the what I was talking about before. It shows with like this say dark blue or whatever this color is because it's transparent, and it is the green overlay. So with blue you have the case when you have just six solar panels and the 5 kilowatt lithium battery, and with green is when you have the combination of heating and the 5 kilowatt-hour battery, 200 amp hour battery. And here you see the charge current, which is like around 50 to 60 maximum, so 55 amps. And what you see here is like this is morning, and then the sun, it's at an angle with the panels, and then the sun, the sun energy will increase as the sun is more straightly hitting the panels. You get the maximum when you are somewhere in the afternoon or around 12, 1 o'clock, something like that. This again real data from my, and it's, I think the data was collected in February or something, so it's a short winter day is not that long. But then when you use this huge PV array that it's used for both heating and charging the lithium battery, then you can redirect, in this case, like in the morning, like in maybe 10 minutes after the morning started, you can connect all these PV panels, all 39. That's what happens here in this point. In the morning, you have very, very little energy from sun. As you see, from six panels, there is not much. But then when you connect all those 39 panels, then you get 55 amps. So starting in the morning at maybe 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning, when the sun just rises up, you get the full charge current, and you will maintain this maximum current because you, like in this case, like maybe 10-15 minutes later, you see a drop here. The drop is because you disconnected one of the panels, because you are hitting 55 amps and you say, okay, that's going to be too much, I need to disconnect one panel. You disconnect one panel and you drop to 50 or something, then sun will continue to put out more power on the panels, then it will rise again, and then the digital MPPT will decide, oh, it's already again at 55, let's drop another panel or something like that. Because you have here like 39 steps, because you have 39 panels, and by combining these six inputs, you can get one, two. If you want three, you select these two. If you want four panels, you select this. If you want five panels, you select this four plus this one. If you want six, you select this two plus this four, and so on. So you can make any combination between one and 39 panels. So you can redirect between one and 39 panels. Any numbers of panels you can be redirected to battery charging. So that's why you see this zigzag in here, because the digital MPPT will connect and disconnect panels in order to maintain the charging current at around 55 amp range. So, and of course, when it's sunny, you like get maybe 41% more energy by doing this. But that's not important, because you have anyway enough energy even with just like six panels probably in that day. But the big advantage is when you get a cloudy day, then like here, this is the same cloudy day that I used in the other examples. In that case, you see with just six panels, the fixed PV array, you get just 93 amp hour. It's the blue graph here. where with the huge PV array that it's also used for heating, you can get 330 amp hour in the same day. But just because you have all those extra panels, you can get way more energy. It's almost like it's a sunny day for you. You don't really care. You can use energy in the same way in a cloudy day as you will use in a sunny day. But this advantage is only when you use both the house heating and electricity together. If you only want electricity and then you only have the SBMS, you cannot connect more than 6 panels because that will just damage your battery. So this is a huge advantage because it can keep your battery smaller, and at the same time the savings that you make on the battery you can invest in more PV panels, and at the same time you heat your home. So it's there are a lot of advantages of combining thermal solar and lithium storage and using just solar energy to provide all the energy that you need for the house. Okay, and then this page explains or gives a few examples of thermal storage and what thermal storage means. And I know many people see here like 8.3 kilowatt hour storage, and it's just a barrel of water, and they probably ask themselves how can you store like kilowatt hour, which for them means electrical energy, but it's not. It's what you need to know is that the units for energy and power can be interchangeable between all units existing. So maybe you are used with BTU for heating, British thermal units, or maybe you are used with joules, or like 1 joule. It's the same thing as 1 watt for 1 second. So joules is energy, but you can also express the same amount of energy in watt seconds. So you say 1 joule, I can say 1 watt second, it will mean the exact same thing. And since I'm like an electrical engineer, I like to see all my power energy and energy displayed in watt hour or kilowatt hour, whatever, in the same unit. So that's the thing with the kilowatt hour. What you do, it's actually you put energy in this like in this water that you have 260 liter of water. This is a 55 gallon barrel for like those that watch this video in US. This is a 55 gallon of a barrel, and that's very popular. It's used in transportation. I mean, people transport all kind of stuff, like maybe orange juice or I don't know, some agricultural chemicals or all kind of stuff in these barrels. But you can also buy this new for about $60. And so it's a very convenient way to store energy, because water is one of the best ways to store thermal energy. And so if you have this like 55 gallon, 206 liter of water, you just fill this with water. I assume water is free, or yeah, it will cost just a few cents. It's not significant. And then if you heat this, let's say from 20 degrees C to 55 degrees C, which means a delta in temperature of 35 degrees C, you need to put 8.3 kilowatt hour of energy in order to heat that water from 20 degrees Celsius to 55 degrees Celsius. And which is, I think it's from 68 Fahrenheit to 131 Fahrenheit. So about 63 degrees Fahrenheit delta. Okay, and then you need to put 8.3 kilowatt hour of energy in order to increase the water temperature from what I mentioned, from 20 degrees Celsius up to 55 degrees Celsius. And I don't say more because this is like a plastic. It's a high density polyethylene type plastic, and it will start lose its shape at around maybe 70 degrees Celsius. So you should not really heat water in this at more than 60 degrees Celsius, absolute maximum, I will say. So 20 to 55 degrees is a good range, and this barrel can be used like forever in this temperature range. And you will say, and the way you get energy back, it's by having this barrel cooling inside your home. So it will release all those 8.3 kilowatt hour while cooling from the 55 degrees that you heat it down back again to 20 degrees Celsius. So it's like if you have this inside your home, you heat it with 8.3 kilowatt hour and then you let it cool, you recover 100% of the energy. So it's like having a battery with like 100% charge discharge efficiency. So it's really good, and it has like an infinite number of cycles. Maybe you need to add a bit of more water if it evaporates or something, but yeah, it's an excellent battery. Even if it's a thermal battery, you don't convert it back to electricity, of course. You use it to store heat and to heat your home or water or whatever you need to heat. It doesn't make sense to use other types of battery. And like the energy density is also quite good. I mean, if you have a lead acid battery, for example, of the same volume as this barrel, you will not be able to store more energy than this. I mean, the energy density for lead acid, with that energy, maybe the battery will have a capacity of 12 kilowatt hour for the same volume like this barrel, but then you can only use maybe half of the energy in lead acid in order not to damage it. So this thermal storage is as good as in term of energy density by volume, it's as good as lead acid, and can be even better. Like if you replace the same barrel with a stainless steel or steel barrel, you can heat this water to a delta of twice as large as this, and maybe you can store 16.6 kilowatt hour in the same volume. So, but like a stainless steel barrel or even a steel barrel will be more expensive than this plastic one. So you need to make a compromise between what you want, like the energy density, or you want to save space, or energy density. And also when you use that barrel, you need to, at higher temperature, you need to thermally insulate it better, especially if it's not inside the house. If it's inside the house, maybe this plastic barrel will need almost no thermal insulation, because the losses, the amount of loss through the barrel, even not insulated, will not be that high, and it will probably be just good enough to keep your house warm. So you can also use pumps and pump through a radiator and heat, or through the in-floor pipe or something, to heat your home if you want. But you can also use it directly, like in the past there were people used, maybe even now, I mean, terracotta type stoves. You burn usually wood or something in a stove that it's made of a special type of bricks. I think the bricks are the special ceramic. It's called terracotta. It's just a ceramic that can resist at high temperatures, and that huge mass of ceramic will store heat from the wood fire, and then it will keep your house warm for a few hours. It's like it was not a huge. It will not take huge amounts of space, and like that brick is not that good of a thermal storage medium. It's not as good as water, for sure. It's more like concrete, like here. Yeah, and this other example, it's concrete, where you can have like a larger temperature delta, because it's like it will not boil or evaporate or anything like that. And like in this example, with 1 cubic meter and higher delta temperature, like it's 3 times more than this barrel, you can store up to 58 kilowatt hour. Even though concrete by volume it's like half as good as water, it can still store huge amounts of energy if can be used at high delta temperature. But then you will need to thermally insulate this cube. But it will not use that much space. Thermal mass is best to be inside the space that you want to heat, because then all the losses to thermal insulation will not be actually losses. It will contribute to heating your house. It's just that you need to thermally insulate that thermal storage in order not to heat too fast the space that you want to heat. That's the only reason. And in my case, as you see here, I already have designed my house with built-in thermal storage, and so my floor it's made out of 14 cubic meters of concrete, and it's thermally insulated from the outside. As you see here, this is thermal insulation, this in blue. So there are no losses to outside, or very little losses to outside. And then the thing is that I cannot use this concrete floor at high temperature delta. I can, in order to be comfortable for you to, it cannot be hot or, I can only use a small delta in temperature, like at most 12 degrees Celsius. And in that case, the maximum storage capacity for my 14 cubic meter concrete floor, it's about 97.4 kilowatt hour, but that's almost good enough for what I need in this home. Maybe I will need to add some small additional thermal storage, but it can almost provide all the thermal storage that I need for the house, and it's free because it's also part of the structural it's a structural part of the house, and I will have needed this concrete slab/foundation anyway, because it's not just for thermal storage, it has dual roles, and there is nothing that I need to add to this to make it a thermal storage. I just need to I didn't do it yet, but this solar heating will be done just probably by next winter when I have the digital MPPT ready. But I will need to put ceramic tiles on top of my concrete floor. I wanted to do that anyway. And before I do that, I will add just normal copper wires. It's a AWG-18, already have the wire, and it's electrically insulated with silicone on top. So it's a flexible wire that you can buy fairly cheaply from China. And so I will add that fairly closely spaced at about 6 centimeters. That's 2 inches or something like that. So fairly closely spaced in and then over that wire I will put that is called, it's it's a leveling stuff, but it's not self-leveling. It's too thin, and I don't like it. It's hard to work with, so it will be something thicker, maybe 3 or 4 centimeters of screed, or I don't know how it's called. It's cement, but it's easier to work with. So I'll put that on top of the heating wires, which heating wires are just basically cheap copper wires that are calculated so they have the right resistance. And on top of that, I will put the ceramic tiles, and that's it. Everything will be solid state, because I don't need to circulate water into that concrete or anything like that. I just have the heating cables connected to digital MPPT and connected to solar panels, and that's it. No moving parts, just electrons. And so it will be extremely reliable and noise free and everything. So in this page I explain exactly how you calculate the length of the cable in order to get the right amount of power that you want. And like for this AWG-18 cable, I don't use more than 10 watt per meter loss on the cable. So the cable, even if it's in like in free air and not embedded into concrete or water, it will still be in the specification. It will not the thermal insulation will not melt or anything. It will be well below 200 degrees Celsius. So the wire is used, it can be used even in free air, but you will not want to do that. You will want to insert it in some sort of thermal mass, because otherwise you will heat way too fast your house, and it will be extremely hot during the day when you have sun, and you heat the cable. Say you want to use an air heater or something an electric air heater. That's a really bad idea. You need to store that in thermal mass, otherwise you will heat too fast and too much the house. You will not be able to live there, and then it will cool also faster, because probably losses will be higher when you heat the room. So yeah, you need thermal mass. You cannot just directly heat the house with solar, because it will need to remain warm during the night or during a few days of cloud. And yeah, here is exactly how this is my the floor plan of my house. It's a rectangular house. It has a simple construction. It's a simple construction, and you can see the heating wires and how they are connected. I will be using just 3 of the 6 outputs from the digital MPPT thermal control, because I want to use the other 3, the first ones with smaller resistive values for maybe heating water or another smaller thermal storage that I will use to preheat the air that will come out of the heat recovery unit. Because the house will have, of course, if you want an efficient house, you need to have a heat recovery unit to recover the heat from the air that you throw outside and put that energy back into the air that you bring inside the house, the fresh air. And of course, that's maybe 60-70% efficient, something like that, a heat recovery unit. And then so the air that will come back in the house, it will be warm because it will be heated by the air that you throw outside, but it will still not be warm enough to be very comfortable. It will mix with the air that is inside the house, so it will not be a big problem. But if you also preheat that air later, then you can maintain a much constant temperature inside the house. So I will have probably a small another small thermal storage unit, maybe 20-30 kilowatt hour, to preheat that air that comes out of the heat recovery unit. So yeah, and here it's just an example of how you switch you have 6 different heat elements connected to the digital MPPT, and you can obtain these 31 steps, and this is calculated what resistance, equivalent resistance, will those parallel heat element have in different combinations, and also what kind of current will go through all of that. So this is how the digital MPPT part works, and it's as you've seen in this graph. So there are exactly, if you want to number, there are exactly 31 sawtooth type wave forms in here up to this point, and then there are another 32 going back down. So because this is a simulation of how this will all work out. And it seems I explain most of what I wanted to explain about the digital MPPT and how it works. Hopefully this is not too long. I don't know, it's a bit more than 1 hour, but anyway, I will edit this a little bit and upload it to YouTube for you to watch. So if you have any questions, you can check this document. It will be in the video description, and also you can play with there is a simulation of this circuit, so you can play online with the simulation and see for yourself how the digital MPPT works. This so you just download this schematic here. You download it, download this text, and then you load in this online circuit simulation tool, and you can play with this. You can close switches, open switches, and here it will be the same. Transfer some of the panels to battery charging, and then you can see exactly how this works. This is only with three inputs and three outputs, so it will not be as let's say as smooth as with the six outputs. So it will be a bit less efficient with just three inputs and outputs, but it's a simplified version, and you can get a very good idea of how exactly this digital MPPT works, because the basic idea is not very complex. It's just the implementation will not be that easy for me. So, but the basic idea is fairly simple. So, and you are welcome to implement this wherever you want, if you want, in your own application or whatever. It's everything is open source, and it's available for you to use. So I want this renewable energy to progress. So I don't want to patent any of my ideas or anything like that. It's not my scope. Yeah, okay, so I think that's it. That's all I wanted to say. I hope this was informative for you, or it made things clearer, because I know it's a bit hard to understand this. It's a completely new product. Nothing like this exists on the market, so people don't know exactly what this thing is about. And I hope this, even if it's a long video, and I hope you were able to watch it all, I hope it will explain a little bit better what it is. But yeah, you can read this paper in more detail and get an even better understanding on how all this works. So yeah, thank you. And if you have any questions, please post a comment below, and I'll be happy to answer. Bye.